Okay. Let me see if this is working. There's captions down the bottom. So I hope that this will be what someone has requested. Hi, and welcome back to Girl and Duck. What did I want to talk to you about today? There's a few things rattling around in my brain, so I thought I'd hop on here and have a chat. And some of this will just be chit chat, just to what I find is that I often go to videos of people who are doing stuff that I want to do just to hang around them, just to be in their energy and just to pick up incidental things, but also to get inspired. So I might not go to their channel to be specifically tutored in something or seeking a lesson in something, more just an energetic shot. So I think that that's where this channel's sort of headed more and more and more. I will, of course, always be sharing more formal tips and ideas and tutoring, but I also will just bring you into my life and my creative world so that you can take from it what you need from it. Okay, so having said that, I really, really, really wanted to show you the books that I bought the other day on my little shopping trip, because in the Duck Pond it is Picture Book Month, and as part of that we have a little competition, and so there's three prize packs for that competition. And so I went out shopping to get books to put in that, and I just really wanted to quickly show you what I bought, because who doesn't love buying books, and who doesn't love buying children's books as well? So, without further ado, I bought some classics. Okay, so this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful retelling of the Little Prince with stunning illustrations, and also a dust jacket hardback. So let me knock. Knock on the hardback. So that is really, really beautiful. And another classic that I got was a Madeline board book. And again, these are so great because the classics are, why are they classics? We need to ask ourselves that. We need to read the classics and read them over and over again and study them and study their illustrations as well, but also the stories and the characters and the settings and the rhythm and rhyme and all that sort of stuff, especially if we're working on picture books. I also got a Room on the Broom. And again, if you're starting out in children's literature and you're just starting to play with writing or illustrating or both, then get amongst the classics. Immerse yourself in the classics. Think about them deeply. This is learning your scales, the children's literature piano. You've got to get in there and learn the scales, so that you're creating from a place of being very familiar and knowledgeable about what it is you're doing. I also picked up All the Ways to Be Smart by Davina Bell and Alison Kalpoise. I hope I've pronounced that correctly. So Davina Bell was our masterclass presenter this week in the Duck Pond. And so it was just fascinating, fascinating masterclass, especially because Davina is not just an author, and she's an author of picture books right through to YA and junior fiction as well, award-winning. She's also a publisher and editor, and she's worked with three major publishers, a firm press being the smallest of them, but the most gung-ho, in that sort of small world of publishing. But she's also started out at Penguin and then went to Allen and Unwin as well. So really rich and interesting career that she's had so far, and lots of experience to draw on for her masterclass, which was just incredible. So of course one of her books is going into the prize packs. In terms of back onto the classics, Also, The Secret Garden is out in picture book form as well. And that's a retelling, and it's illustrated by Adelina Lirius, which is beautiful, beautiful. I just don't even have to look. You know, I just can just go like this and open a page, and you know it's going to be moody and full of I was listening to an artist speak recently, and she was talking about reward viewing. And this is something that, as illustrators of children's literature, you know, you need to be looking at all the time. Are your images rewarding to look at? Are there hidden things in there? Are they multi-layered? Is there a reward for the child to look at your illustrations? So, and that's also for you as an author, thinking about, especially if you're writing a picture book, thinking about how it's going to be illustrated and imagining it. Never, never, never telling the illustrator what to do, or even writing that in your cover letter or anything. But you know, never being prescriptive, but always having that visual idea of what your book's going to look like. And I'll come to that a bit more in a minute. I also got a copy of Emma Quay's latest book, Happy All Over, which is really making an impact. It just came out this week, and Emma Quay was with us last month for a masterclass, and she spoke at length about the creation of this exquisite book. So I was really excited to get a copy of that, and her masterclass is still in the Duck Pond at the moment, so people are still catching up on that because everything's recorded. But just the different ways that she created these little coloured raindrops as well, and how she incorporated all that into her work. If you don't follow her on Instagram, then you should, because she's an extremely generous creator. And there's a lot of stuff on Instagram and also on her website and that helps you, you know, that goes into the details of how she created this book. So, and also she very generously gave us in the Duck Pond, but I also think it's on her website, a recipe for skin tones, because skin tones are so, so important. That we have be a very diverse approach to skin tones in our illustrations. And so Emma gave some beautiful recipes for just getting those skin tones just so. So that's really, really cool as well. And the other really beautiful picture book that's going into the prize pack is this one, which I'm quite smitten with this one, Always Never Always by Meg McKinlay and Layla Rudge. And this came out just before Christmas, Australian picture book. Meg is in WA, but it's just so beautifully written. It's such a beautiful, beautiful, sensitive book. And it has a beautiful rhythm. The rhyme is spot on. It's really beautiful illustrations. So lots of reward looking in there. So I grabbed a copy of that one too. And I'm also putting this year copies each. There's three prize packs. So each pack will have a copy of one of the Truly Tan books. There's eight books in this series, but I've chosen my three favourites, and there'll be signed copies in there. So I'm really excited about putting all that together and sending out books and making up prizes and just getting in amongst it. Now, let me just write myself a note here. What did I want to say? So I had a coffee and a cardamom scroll for breakfast. Can you believe that? And I'm a bit loopy this morning. What I wanted to share with you in terms of helping you with tips and stuff was two of the most important things that I took away from Davina Bell's masterclass this week in the Duck Pond. And I did share this with the duckies more or less straight away. So if you're a duckie, I'm sorry to bore you again. But for the greater community that like these videos, I want to share these two important things. There was a million things that Davina shared, but there were two things that really spoke to me and spoke to my experience from working in-house as an editor as well. And one of the things was we can't underemphasize the importance of getting down to a child's level when you are writing for children. And this is something that people seem to think that they can do automatically, but they can't. It takes skill and it takes practice and it takes getting to know, pointing to the books, it's getting to know children's literature, really immersing yourself in it, and so that it becomes part of your, you know, part of your makeup. It's in your bones how it all works, and you're not sort of writing it as an adult looking into from the outside in and going, well, I can knock up a children's book in a weekend, you know, or I've got something important to tell those kids, you know, and writing a book. Now, it might sound like I'm joking, but when you work in-house, if you were to see the sheer volume of manuscripts that come into a children's publishing house that are written from the perspective of an adult who knows best, or an adult who hasn't spoken to a child for 30 years or has dashed off something for, you know, their grandchild who then is their only critic and says it's great, grandma. All right. And then on the basis of that, they think they've written a children's book that is publishable. This is where people get misled. All right. This is where they get confused. And this is where they fall down and they, you know, submit stuff and then they are affronted because it's rejected. You must immerse yourself in the world of children in order to be able to write for them and to entertain them and to, if you want to, educate them. You have to be down with the kids. Now, that doesn't mean you have to be out there all the time and working with children and, you know, have a whole family of children around you, but you do have to have some sort of access to the world of children and the world of children's literature as well. Again, immersing yourself in this stuff, going to the library, borrowing as many picture books at a time as you can, borrowing the classics, borrowing the new ones, borrowing the bad ones. You know, borrow some bad picture books and decide why you think they're bad. Critique them. You know, critique other, you will learn. You will learn so much from the mistakes of others. And bad picture books do get published, but I'm sure that's not your goal. It's to publish a bad picture book. So have a look at some picture books that you think are stinkers and work out why you think they're stinkers. Maybe they've got no heart, you know, or maybe they're just dull, you know, or maybe they're, the rhyme is clumsy or forced, and you know, bad rhyme gets through the goalkeepers sometimes. You know, I have had published books in my hand and read them out loud and gone, oh, that could have done with another edit. I stumbled on this particular rhyme, or, you know, this particular rhyme doesn't sit well within the scheme of the book, or whatever. But we need to think critically about what we're writing and about what is out there in order to become, to master what we're doing. I was listening to a painting podcast this morning, and the guy that was being interviewed was amazing. I can't remember. The podcast is called Learn to Paint. It's an American, so the Learn to Paint podcast. So get onto that if you're a painter or an artist and you really want to get amongst it, because it's a great podcast. But I can't remember who the bloke was that was talking this morning. But anyway, he was saying, and he was talking in terms of a painting, all right? So you know how you go from big shapes and then you get smaller and smaller and smaller. So he was saying, start out as a stonemason and end up as a jeweler. Okay, start as a stonemason and end as a jeweler. Now, he was talking in terms of the painting, start out big and then chip down. But I love this metaphor for aspiring authors as well, because when you start to write fiction, 9 times out of 10, you are a bit of a stonemason. You know, you're kind of like clunking around, chipping off bits of rock here and there, and it's all a bit awkward and a bit kind of ugly, and this can go on for a long time. And in fact, it's most books that you write, doesn't matter how much experience you've got. Every book that you begin writing, you start off as a stonemason, chip, 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 and it's a bit clumsy and clunky. But you fine tune and you fine tune and you fine tune so that by the end of the book, you are working more like a jeweler. You've developed your eye for detail. You've developed your eye for the story. You've developed your ear for the language of the story, your ear for the dialogue of the characters. All this develops over time so that you become the jeweler of your book, and your book becomes a jewel rather than a big clunky rock. All right. I love that metaphor. I think that's really beautiful and can be really helpful to those of you who are losing heart because it all seems so hard and you're wondering why it's so hard. It's just that you're in the stonemason stage. Okay, you need to give yourself time to learn the skills that will take you through to being a jeweler so that you can get all the facets of your book working together. So that was a beautiful little metaphor that I heard today. And again, this comes back to this stuff that I'm always talking about, is how there is no need to compartmentalize your creativity. There is really no need to call yourself a writer as opposed to an artist, or an illustrator as opposed to a poet. You know, whatever it is that lights you up in terms of your creativity, that's where your energy needs to flow, and you can embrace it all. You can be the verb and not the noun. As Oscar Wilde used to say, you know, don't label yourself too quickly. Don't label yourself as a picture book author if you want to write other stuff. You know, so it's just about, I know the world at large calls for labels, and, you know, Instagram and those sorts of places call for labels, but doesn't mean you have to internalize them and limit yourself to what you're doing. And for me, this is an ongoing lesson. It's one that I preach, but it's also one that I have to teach myself over and over again, because I think, you know, being a Taurus, I've always been one who will be methodical and slow and want to master the one thing that they're working on and then forget that there's all these other things that I could be doing as well. I'm not advocating for people to be scattered, but I am saying it's okay to be interested in multiple things and be multi-passionate, and there is a way to live your life that way and be very, very fruitful in what you create. So that was the first, going back to Davina, that was the first thing. Get down to the kids' level. Borrow a kid if you need to. Spy on kids very discreetly. It was something that I did constantly while writing Truly Tan, was to, you know, be listening in on children's conversations. It sounds creepy, but, you know, don't be creepy, of course. But, you know, just keep an eye on them. Listen to what they're saying in shops. I'd be looking between the, I remember, you know, the card stand spinning once in a shop, and I'm kind of turning the card stand very discreetly like Maxwell Smart, but over the other side there's a couple of, you know, sort of 8-year-old girls chatting about something, and I'm not only am I listening to what they're saying, but I'm looking at them. What are they wearing? What's their stance? What's their attitude? Because I'm picking up all those cues for my fiction. And because I don't have daughters, it was always a very interesting thing for me to immerse myself a little bit more into the world of girls, all right? And I'm not even going to discuss the gender issues there. I just can't. But that's something that's really helpful. So to help you get down to the children's level, get around kids and jot down things and little things that they say and little things that they do, the way they wear, what they're wearing, how they're behaving, all those sorts of things. Keep a record of all these things, and remember that this is a true thing. You know, this is a true thing that happens in publishing houses for children. There's so many books and manuscripts come in that the writer is very disconnected from the world of a child. really, really hasn't taken the time to get to that, to get down to their level and think about what the children want and what they'll enjoy. So that's the first thing that I took from Davina. Now I'm looking around. I haven't got it. Doesn't matter. The other thing that I took, remembered from Davina that really stuck out for me is a very basic thing, but it is always when you're writing a picture book, creating a picture book, always make a dummy. Always make a dummy book. Making a dummy book of your book will show you so much about the story. It will showcase things that you cannot see when it's just laid out on a couple of pieces of paper and typed up. Say you've got 500 words and even if you've paginated it, you know, broken it into what goes on what page and laid it out on your, you know, all typed up neatly, something gets lost in that translation. Something that you can't identify until you actually make a dummy book and you're sitting there with the, this is my scrap where I write notes on, where you can actually turn the pages, all right? And you can look and see and hear how this is going to be laid out. Now, illustrators will, of course, be doing this, but writers might not, it might not occur to writers to do this, but I strongly recommend it as part of the process. I have a picture book that I reserve in totally for my own stories, and I type up my stories, cut them out, and blue tack each new story into this picture book so that I can read the picture book and get a sense of the rhythm, get a sense of the page turns. And then I'm also getting these visual cues of where the story might be slumping and where the story might be too quiet or just not working for some other reason. That becomes really clear to me. And again, this is like painting, you know, when you are in the middle of a painting and you look at it in reverse in a mirror, you see things that you don't see when you stand in front of it. The same for me with photographing. I photograph my art all the time. Just on my phone, because the minute I photograph a drawing or an illustration or anything that I've drawn or painted, the minute that I photograph it, I see what's missing. I see the problem. I mean, not all of them, but I do see, that, you know, that needs, it can be the tiniest thing. Like it just needs a line there, or it needs a color splash here, or it needs a tweak there or something. It just, the looking at it through the eyes of a camera is just another way. It just lights up other areas of the creative brain. And again, this thing about holding a mirror up to your artwork and looking at it in reverse. And it's, this is the same with a dummy of your book. You will find that that is super, super important to your success if you are going to be writing children's picture books. And again, in terms of paging too, you might find that, you know, 32 pages is too long and you might want to condense it and make it into a 24-page book and see how that works. That can be really helpful as well. So they are the two key things I got from this amazing masterclass with Davina Bell. If you don't know Davina, please go and have a look at her website. There's lots to read on there. There's lots of cute stuff to, you know, just get into Davina's world. It's really rich and interesting and quirky. I think that's all I've got to say today. It's nice and quiet here. I now have polished floors in my studio. I cannot believe it. We're getting so close to moving out there, and I will make some kind of a video and take you down there and show you the end result. But yes, they came at Sparrow's Fart this morning to put on the coat of the stinky stuff. And so you literally can't go in there today. At first I was concerned that the cats would go in because the door doesn't close on the studio yet. It's not, and one of the windows is still being fixed because they're all upcycled windows. And I thought, oh no, if the cats walk on the polished floor, you know, that's not set, we'll have all these paw prints all over the floor. But then I went down and stuck my head in and went, whoa, I couldn't. I could hardly breathe. It's like sticking your head inside a giant bottle of nail polish remover so the cats won't have anything to do with it. Lucky, hey? So, yeah, so that's happening, and there'll be a lot of digging going on over the next few days too as they lay the stormwater pipes and set. There's going to be a tap and stuff down there so that I can wash my brushes and do all those groovy things. So there's still lots of little things to do on the studio, but it is coming together. The other thing that I'm doing, and I hope you all do this when you've got something that, you know, like if you're moving into a new house or you've got, even if you're anticipating, you know, doing up your room or you're creating an altar or something, it's really nice to, I like to stockpile little things, just little things. So I've started stockpiling a special little bundle of treats to have to take to the studio. So I've bought a doormat that's got rabbits on it, and I've got some very special Japanese incense. I've got some wooden flowers. I'll show you those. They're really quirky. What else have I got? I've got a peach selenite crystal, which is really gorgeous. And so just a group of little things. Oh, and one of the duckies gave me some really pretty glass birdies. So I'll put those down there. So I've just got this little stockpile of treats that will go into the studio, and I'm saving them for the day. And even I've got a new chair. Hallelujah, finally got a new swirly chair, and I haven't even taken that out of the box yet because, again, I want to unbox it in the actual studio and set it up. It's an IKEA chair. Let's set it up down there and but not have it here and get used to it. Like, I want it to be brand spanking new when it goes into the studio. So there you go. I scratched myself, didn't I? Weird. All right, my love. Thank you for listening. If you like this channel, please subscribe and like, because it's super, super helpful. The YouTubes love it. It's really important. Otherwise, I will see you again very, very soon. Thanks for listening, and bye.